1871, authorizing amendments to the Murray Mobile Franchise Agreement extending franchise to June 30th, 2015.
A few weeks ago, I got a call from Mark Ingridge. He works for Murray's assistant district manager, and he had no idea that these negotiations were going on. So I told him, explain what was happening, and we do need to extend the contract with them. So we got that set up late last week, and he also said they would be interested in also trying to give us a bid. I told him right now I didn't think we were taking bids, but he was more than welcome to come to the meeting next week and talk to council. So, but yeah, we still need to do, and nothing would change on their end. I believe nothing would change with the contract, just extend it to June 30th of 2015.
I just reminded us all that we wanted to talk about this once again, what value it was. I read the notes for the public safety committee meeting. It sounds like it's going to go no recommendation to not just what I got. So do we know, I've never seen an officer on that road patrol. And I know that the people that are driving on it are still driving 35 or more on the front. All of them, really. So I'd be interested to see how many citations or notifications we've issued along that road. I know it's a safety issue. I know that you're referring it or looking at talking to Ken about parking along that road. So I'm sure we all talked about wanting to go back to 35.
In the start of the meeting, there's quite a lot of traffic on that road, and it's not a great road to turn onto it, and it's a curve. And with all of the traffic, Thursday morning when I went to work, I had 143 cars parked on both sides of the street. I don't know if that's in excess from what the zoning code is, but that's a lot of cars, and we've got cars trying to come out and enter on. From the entrance to the left and right, and they have to pull forward past the parked cars in order to see on their left and on their right. Some mornings it's almost like charter practice. And we've got the semis that are trying to either come out or back in, and there's a lot going on that road. You know, we really need to hear 50 and she's going to get at 25.
I can't give you statistics on the citations on it, but I can see them up by the rear window. And they have them fairly regularly and see them up. I don't know if that's correct on every speed. I suspect we would need more enforcement if we actually want to get down to 25. There's a lot of slop and enforcement everywhere else. Most cities, 25 really means to see them go back to the 30 as far as enforcement priorities. I don't know exactly where we want to fall on the enforcement on the air, but there is enforcement out
there. I drove down it today just to get a feel for driving. I don't drive it. I don't work right without it. So, and there are a lot of vehicles, but we do have a white line that indicates that there's street parking there. On both sides of the road. It's a little faded on the east side of the road, but the west side of the road is clearly marked. All the vehicles are inside of that white line, so none of them are hinging on the roadway. But just the fact that all those cars are there, of course, means slow down because the road's not big, and so you just tend to go slower. My wife made a good point. Most cities have 25 miles an hour as their standard speed limit, state law. That unless otherwise posted, it's 25 miles an hour, and the only road that we really have that exceeds it is Ellington, which is four lane. So I'm not a big proponent of having real slow speed limits. After going out there and looking, seeing for myself. are using it. My natural instinct was to slow down, but if people aren't slowing down, I can see where people might be, say, it's a safety hazard. I did see one business where very few, I think maybe six vehicles were parked inside of the yard, and the rest of the yard is being used for business purposes. So again, that gets back to the zoning code. Are they providing adequate parking for the types of business that they're going? And maybe get some of those vehicles off the road. But I, right now, after driving down that title, I support it quite much on my street.
I asked Richard to forward message off again. Ken is off this week.
He'll be back tomorrow.
Oh, he'll be back tomorrow. Okay. So Ken has been important.
Then I'm fine with 25. I just wanted to raise your question again. Just note that once you cross Ellington, it's residential and 35. So it's going to be 35 anyway. That's going to be, you know, residential. So people are coming in from Algona tend to not slow down. I don't go that way anymore because I do 25 and people ride the whole way. So I'm fine. I just want to make sure that it's brought up again. And Clint made the point that we want to make sure
we'll have to look up to see how our temporary lowering the speed limit was written, whatever, because we may have to repeal that or redo it to make it legal.
I would like to see if we consider raising it before we actually do it. I would like to see an actual track study of the set triangles out of the driveways coming out through those parked cars and people parking close enough to the driveway entrances. There isn't, as you see, if you've got a higher speed limit, you've got some, say, a three-space setback before you're allowed to park. So you've got clear sight lines at the driveways, and you don't have that as long as we have parked right up to the driveway. So I'd like to see actually hearing an analysis of my guess is it just does not currently meet the standards.
Well, I think what you're suggesting is all fine and everything else. We're just incurring some costs that...
Only if we actually want to raise
it. So, yeah. At this point right now, I don't think see any reason to have any traffic studies. My personal feeling is safety-wise, it's lower at 25. And that keeps the city... I mean, if something happened out there, they got hit at 35, there's always this situation where we had posted an unsafe speed limit. So I don't know how that holds up in courts anymore, but I know years ago it used to hold up in courts.
Yeah. And especially with the church there, pedestrian traffic on Sundays, a lot of pedestrian crossing that blocked. The fatality rate being hit at 35 is more than double the fatality rate being hit at 25. Human bodies don't take that very well.
Okay, what do we need to do then to get the research to make sure that we are legal on our opening of the speed
limit? I've made a note to look at that ordinance to look at the wording that we lowered it. So
okay.
If we need to repeal it.
All right.
I did make a note.
Any further council discussion on that? Next item, supplementary training for boards and commissions.
So, based on recent events, I think it's necessary that some of our, and I know that the insurance company and the law requires the appointed board members and some training. I think this should be one that we spend money on, even if it's just a chairperson at this time, is looking at bringing parliamentarians in to do some training on how to actually run a deputy meeting. There should be attached to the packet. There's a person that Union I guess is seeing Jurassic Parliament. That's just JurassicParliament.com. She's got tons of different options. There's a 1 hour session, there's a 3 hour session, there's a 6 hour session. It's probably a little expensive, but I would go for that one. She has some online training. She's got some articles and papers and
booklets available. I think it's just council saying, yes, we're interested in doing this, and then letting the mayor kind of take it and allow it. And she doesn't have prices on the website, and I haven't really had time to talk to her. But I think it would be much more important. Council discussion?
Being one that attended one of her sessions when she first came to council, I find it very interesting and worthwhile, and it does, so you can't grasp everything in a 1 to 3 hour session, but it piques your interest, and I get an ongoing email service from her, so every periodic time she'll send an email out addressing an issue and allows you to read up on it. Kind of refresh your mind and think about some of the issues that we go through in our meetings. Proper, stomping on people's opinions or their time when they have before, or something like that. Just the basics. I think it's worthwhile.
Especially for some of the work committees that have part of the judicial authority over some issues. I think it would probably be a money saver in the long run just to ensure that when something goes to court, like when the minutes of a meeting are pulled, we're not handing red meat to the other side by saying, look, you didn't even follow your own rules in holding this hearing.
This kind of goes along the lines of later recording committee meeting. They have
Gail Bennett.
Gail Bennett, thank you. That comes in and takes minutes. They record the, at least for Planning Commission, and I know Civil Services does as well. Just rolling the rest of the boards in as well. Because I don't attend those meetings typically, but it'd be nice to hear the public hearing. Geez, videos help a lot. But, you know, if you were coming into a recording, you would have to be right now. So,
if I could ask staff a question, we ordinarily in the budget have far more money allocated to training than we ever actually spend. Is that true again this year?
Well, I can say that I just gave us about $1,000 in training because I was going out of town with one of my staff. We have that. Yeah, we do. We do that. I just thought it was time to go, but we do have some money.
I don't know how much it's in shape, but
yeah.
I don't think we would need any additional appropriation for this.
Especially in the 511, which is through the legislative council. 513, we have well, budget left. We have any questions for a lot of
ideal if we all report, not just the chair, but if scheduling is a challenge, it can't be maybe something.
I'm just going to kind of touch on the one issue about recording of meetings and committees and stuff like that. I do believe that is a requirement.
It's been a suggestion, and I thought it was a great suggestion for the simple reason that information is huge. So if you have a recording for a backup, I think that it's not a secret. Being recorded a lot of times when somebody brings in their camera.
Most aren't, honestly. Most aren't, but the other issue is who would do the recording and how would that recording be done? And, you know, I mean, are we going to bring it up on system? Who's going to be trained to do that? Or are we going to pay for the purpose?
Bring up the FDR and hit record. pilot and everything. She just has it totally set up and ready. All you have to do is record the video and then stop and be done.
I don't want to see it be a mandatory thing. I think it's something the chair should have discretion of that committee to do. I know if we're negotiating a contract with, like, waste management, as the waste management committee, or the solid waste committee, I don't want reporting in place because we might not, I mean, we might be talking about stuff that might not come to fruition. And I'd like to have the freedom and flexibility to speak freely in a negotiation setting and not have either side bound by any of that talk until something's actually reduced to writing.
But in secret of this, you know, we have those pilot ad hoc committees. I'm talking about your standing regular committees that meet on a regular basis. That's the thing I'm talking about. I'm not worried about negotiating committees or anything like that. You know, you know, negotiation, obviously, or the waste management negotiation. That's right. Not standing committees that take place on a regular basis.
The only thing I see with this is, could we have conflicting dates of meetings, and then, like, for example, of the planning commission meets the same night as the council meeting does, once a month. We've had other conflicting meetings where you just have to figure out which one you're going to record in. So,
Gail brings her own tape recorder.
Well, yeah, I was going to say, the planning commission's not an issue. They're already getting recorded by Gail, but she brings her own recorder. She does that at that time. It's not an issue.
I just use an example.
Right, and the other meetings, for the most part, are usually not the same though.
But they have
a schedule. They have to work out the schedule, you know, to comply with the case.
We're in the process of getting a portable recording system anyway that can be used in the conference room as well until this system can be replaced. And ultimately, the goal is to have a hardwired system here and a portable system for meetings that we have to move to the gym. So, you know, as long as we staff can be aware of the meeting beforehand and set it up, and we can record it and then she can have it on the network. We wouldn't be responsible for doing that. I would think that the department head would be the one who would actually record the meeting and take the notes. And if that's what the answer is, she'd go off to the department head. But, you know, when we get that system, and we've got quotes, we just can't get on and reply to it. So
they're getting better. They're getting more information.
Well, just as long as, number one, is I don't want to end up finding where we're incurring some additional labor costs and getting this done. And number two is, I don't want to have where there's specific nights that might be available, because sometimes we have a kind of a difficult time trying to get everybody together. And Leanne can attest to that, because the VFR had to change everything in their whole system to adjust to her. So, I mean, that you have that situation. So, I don't want to see it mandatory because of, and I would say do it whenever is possible. And if we get the portable recorder, then that should be an answer to it. But I don't want to see everything have to work around that one recorder.
I do think we should also get guidance from the attorney on what matters should be handled in open committee sessions that are recorded, and what matters, if any, should be in closed sessions that are not recorded and available. Because, of course, once anything is recorded, even if we later decide not to do whatever was said on that tape itself is a public record that's discoverable and can be used against the Supreme Court of Law.
That's a good point.
That was my point as well, as talking to Carol about even her thoughts on recording committees at all. You know, she has provided forward against it, but also to Josh's voting not. But I know some cities, for example, report their city council executive session. And there is a prohibition of releasing what happens in executive session. That's why it's there.
But once you create a public record of it, there's always a possibility that someone will go to court and demand access to this recording or that recording because they think you did something improper in that executive session. And that does, in some cases, inhibit what's supposed to be happening in executive session, where you can frankly discuss negotiation topics that could be harmful to all parties involved in that week.
The only issue I have with recording something and have a permanent record of it is a lot of committee meetings can be used to brainstorm and just throw ideas out there. And when someone has access to a public record like that, they can take excerpts of it and use it inappropriately. And why would we subject ourselves to that if it's not something that is going to be used or considered? I mean, you'd be held accountable for something that you never had any intention of following through on. There's some issues there that I think you got to be cautious of. I mean, we keep minutes of these, you know, our standing committees for a reason. I mean, we document the stuff that took place in that meeting that's important and appropriate and to the point, sometimes you stray off topic in those committee meetings because they're loose for life. So.
The meetings are open to the general public to begin with, correct? If anything that's said in a public meeting is already out there, I don't care either way, you record it or you don't record it, but I don't understand is why we have a fear of recording something. If you were going to say something at a public meeting, I would assume that you would be standing behind what you said. Now, you're saying that you're afraid someone might misconstrue what you were saying. Well, there you go. The best way to find out exactly what you said is to replay that recording, and then you don't have any room for he said, she said.
I like committee meetings a little bit more laid back, but in some cases, and not necessarily committee meetings, but maybe some of the commissions or the boards or whatnot, there is a very serious lack of professionalism. So while I like the collaborative nature and the brainstorming and discussion that happens in committee meetings, they're public meetings. And just because somebody's sitting in the audience doesn't mean that we can express ourselves in a professional way. And I think the recording, if nothing else, can kind of help with that.
Well, and I think that it helps move the that's like the future where all our committee meetings are in telephone. And I know that we're going to be moving down that direction.
Another concern that I have with other jurisdictions is a member of the public will bring something to a committee meeting that nobody on the committee considers particularly important. But that member of the public can document that they brought to the city and discussed it there. So the city is officially on notice of whatever this situation is. And if the city doesn't act on it, the city can be liable for failing to act on it. And if you only have the citizen's side of what was said at the meeting, well, they can say they brought much more to your attention than they really did. Say, oh, I came in and I told them all about this intersection and how many cars have already been crashed there. But they actually came in and said that they'd like speed bumps. But after somebody gets hit and there's a lawsuit, they say, I told the city all about this. It's the city's fault for failing to respond.
That's why it's customary ever since I've been on the committee, the citizens come in and ask something like this. They bring it in writing and then the committee goes over it, and if it has to come to council or whatever, if not, the committee responds to that person in writing, and there is no verbal. Normally, that you get no public input from anybody at the committee.
Do we
call
committees around that topic? Any further council discussion on this?
Councilman,
we want to take a step. Are you ready,
Councilman? I'm Carol.
Well, that's a good question.
made a note, that's that good, I was making a note for myself there, because I didn't really need one of those.
Same word for friend over there.
I was, okay.
Next on our agenda, we have executive session for electric charter to refer our committee to 4230-140-4A for 20 minutes.